Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Class of 20 Live today. It's Saturday, November 3rd, 2012. Peggy, Kim, and I are so pleased to have our special guest, Lucy Gray, talking about the Global Education Conference. Kim is still away for a little while, and so we send out again our appreciation to Lori Moffitt, who's been our backup moderator. And as well in the chat, anyone needs closed captioning, we again thank Tammy Moore for being with us today. I did want to go through a couple of details about the show that will help you if you're new. We do have a couple of ways of collecting resources for you, and one of them being our live binder. And I think Peggy just dropped a link to the live binder in the chat. And what's great about this is that all our resources for Classroom 20 Live, including our survey, which pops up at the end, it's located there, and the sites and references that Lucy is going to be giving us throughout the show are also posted in the live binder. We do have a website, which in addition to the live binder, has a terrific resource for you. We post in our archives and resources page the complete Blackboard Collaborate recording, the audio file, an MP4 file that's embedded. You can place wherever you need to do that. If you want to put it in another location to help staff with some professional development. We have a link to the chat log today, which sometimes flies by rather quickly and you might miss a link or two. You're going to either find it in the chat log or in the blog post that we post the links in, or in that live binder. So you've got three different ways to get the information during the show. Can't think of anything right now that's included in the resources and website, but I'm going to ask you to take out the whiteboard tools and show me where you are located in the world map today. So if the left-hand side of the whiteboard or the whiteboard tools, the second one down, you click on the laser pointer, drag it with your mouse to where you're located in the world. A few people dropping out of their location in the chat. Thank you, Lori and Rhonda. I'm in St. Catharines, Ontario. So get my laser pointer to work, I'll get myself over there. There we go. Peggy's in Phoenix, Arizona. Lori just told us where we are. Tammy, I guess I'm every Saturday. It's terrible. I don't remember. So type in the chat where you're located. And as Peggy said, we may be missing a lot of people on the Eastern Seaboard because of the remains of Sandy and the destruction that's happening. So, you know, we need to send out our prayers again and for those people who have been tremendously affected by this storm. Great. Thanks, everybody, for showing us where you are. It's always fun to see the global connections that we make today. I'm going to ask you to take part in our poll questions. And the first one is, have you ever participated in the Global Education Conference? So your voting options are just below your name. The right-hand side icon is a little check mark. If you click on it, you get a drop-down menu. Make your choice of yes or no. And I'll wait just a couple of minutes while people post their votes, and I think we maybe we're almost all there. And what are our results? Third. Other people. So we do have a fair number who have not attended. I know this is going to help you walk through how to participate. Okay, move to our next question, which is poll question two. Have you ever participated in any virtual conference? So that's a green check if it's a yes and a red X if it's no. I have to ask you to go vote again because I forgot to clear the vote. So a few more people waiting for them to vote. I think I'm seeing by the votes that the majority of the people here have attended a session. So there you go, 63% of people. Our last poll question is, do you or your students connect with other teachers in classrooms in another country? So green check if you yes, and a red X if no. I think most people have had a chance to vote. Let's see the results. More than 40% say no, they don't link up with teachers or classrooms in other countries. So I'm sure that Lucy's going to have some tips for how you might be able to do that. Thank you, everyone, for participating in our poll questions and chat. It's my opportunity to introduce you to Lucy today. Some of you may know her already, but she's an educational consultant, and she's worked with a variety of institutions on 21st century learning initiatives, one of them including the Consortium for School Networking's Leadership for Mobile Learning Project. She began her career as a primary grade teacher in Chicago Public Schools and has served in various capacities related to educational technology at the University of Chicago's Laboratory Schools, Urban Education Institute, and the Center for Elementary Mathematics and Science Education. In 2007, Lucy founded the Global Education Collaborative, a network for educators interested in project-based learning, which has been expanded into the Global Education Conference. She's been awarded Google Certified Teacher, AVL Distinguished Educator Distinctions, and you can find her with more information at lucygrayconsulting.com. So I'm just about to turn the mic over to you, Lucy. We have a newbie question. How did the Global Education Conference get started, and what is the purpose of the conference? So welcome, Lucy.
Thank you, Lorna and Peggy. I'm so happy to be here on a Saturday morning with you here in Chicago. And this is a great question to get going with this morning. We started 3 years ago, and I am the co-founder along with Steve Hargadon of Classroom 2.0, as you may know. You know him very well. And I had started my, this is a long story. Where do I begin? Okay, so in 2005, I became one of the privileged Apple Distinguished Educators, which is a community for people who are authoring and advocating and are ambassadors of Apple technologies, people who have done extraordinary things with the technology in the classroom. And it changed my life. And at our institute that summer, where we become ADEs, we talked a lot about The World is Flat by Thomas Friedman and about Dan Pink's A Whole New Mind. Those were the two books that were on everybody's mind. And consequently, Apple did their next institute in 2006 abroad, and we went to Berlin and Prague and created digital content along the way and lesson plans and all sorts of cool stuff. And it was a life-changing experience. And what occurred to me was that we have the technology now, back in 2006. We have the technology to connect classrooms. Why is this not a standard part of every classroom? Why are we not using iChat or whatever to have conversations and learn from each other more? It just seems to be, kind of the obvious use of technology, and why are we not leveraging it more? So at the same time, Steve was starting Classroom 2.0, and he had 13,000 people the first month. He doesn't remember this, but I remember it distinctly because I was like so blown away by the fact that he could gather teachers together so quickly and so many of them in one place, and they could all learn from each other. And if you're not familiar with Classroom 2.0, it's all about new and emerging technologies, and there's over 70,000 people in there now, I believe. So Steve built that space in a platform called Ning, and I took inspiration from him, and I started a Ning on global collaboration. I really think that the relationships between teachers are what makes global projects happen, and people need to be able to connect in some way. And there were a lot of different isolated, siloed initiatives along these lines, but not, one big place where everybody can come and find each other, I guess, and talk about their work. So I started the Global Education Collaborative in 2007, and it was fairly slow going getting people in there. We now have 13,000 people. We just hit 13,000 people last week, and that's all due to, I think, the conference that we've built over the past 3 years. So Steve came to me, I want to say it was at EduCon. he remembers it differently, but I remember him coming to me and saying, I want to talk to you. I have an idea. What can we do, or actually, what can we do to significantly impact education with your community and Illuminate, which is what this platform used to be called. Blackboard Collaborate used to be called Illuminate, and Steve was a consultant for them. And he said, why, you know, what can we do with those two things that will really majorly impact education, which is rather ambitious, and I had never been, you know, had thought that large, I guess. And at the same time, I was really impressed with in the K-12 online conference, Peggy, and thought, why don't we do a virtual conference? You know, that seems to be the no-brainer with this platform. We could do something similar to what they're doing. And so we started this conference, and it's basically, you know, the two of us driving it with a lot of volunteers and a lot of people who are helping out. And one of them is in the audience right now, Alen Delic from, I'm pronouncing his name right, from Croatia, has been a loyal member and of our leadership team for the past couple of years, helping with moderating sessions and that sort of thing. And I actually had the privilege of meeting Alen in Chicago when he came through town last year. So pretty exciting stuff. So that's how it started. And the purpose of the conference is we have a mission statement, and I'm going to bring up some slides to show you, and hopefully this will work. These are slides that I used for another webinar recently. And hopefully this will show you our mission statement. Let's see if I can do this correctly. These are some slides that I did for another webinar, and I'm going to scroll through them. And if you can't see this, please, I'll post it in the chat as well. I'm not going to go through all these slides because this is kind of my Why Global presentation, but there's one slide that kind of explains our mission. Can you guys see that? Okay, where it says mission on there? Okay, it's slide number 11 on this slide deck. And our mission is to be a community practice where people connect and build the professional relationships necessary for effective collaboration across borders. And via the social network, educators and organizations from all over the world share conversations, resources, projects, and initiatives with a strong emphasis on promoting global awareness, fostering global competency, and inspiring action towards solving real-world problems. And our ultimate goal is to help prepare students for a rapidly changing and complex world. If you can't see, here's the link directly to the slides. And it is slide 11 is the mission. And you can scroll through these on your own, in your own leisure. There's a lot more content in there. But this is really the crux of what we're trying to do. And I was also personally inspired by Vicki Davis and Julie Lindsay of the Flat Classroom Project, because I saw with them, they were friends and colleagues first through social media. And they built a really strong model for global collaboration because they knew each other. And I think that the best kinds of projects succeed when you know your partner in crime with this, and you take time to, you know, you're invested in it personally, as opposed to maybe signing up with a service that may connect you with a pen pal or something. You don't know the other person on the other end. There's no, if somebody drops off, you don't know what happened to them. You know, and I think that through social media, we can kind of build those relationships and see where our commonalities lie and the potential for global collaboration exists. So that's the point of all this. And we want organizations, we want individuals, we want anyone to share their work and to tell us about what they do, and so that people and our membership are aware of what the possibilities are. So let me take you to the space right now. It's globaleducationconference.com. And I want to give you kind of an overview of this, because some people think this is overwhelming. By the way, if we haven't gone into the basics of this, this conference takes place starting a week from Monday on November 12th. It goes around the clock and for 5 days during International Education Week. And we purposely picked that week because we thought it was a nice and it would be a nice partner in publicizing all of this. And we start about, 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning, U.S. time. Our opening keynote is going to be Tony Wagner. And here's, you guys have the link? Okay. You can look at it on your own. And I'm going to, it's globaleducationconference.com. So this is going to go around the clock, basically. They're in the wee U.S. hours, there are not a lot of presentations, but this year we're getting more. It's interesting. Anyway, we're going to start off about 9 o'clock in the morning Eastern time with Tony Wagner. We may have an opening session before that to kind of explain things to people. And Tony Wagner has a new book on innovation, which I think is really sets the tone for the rest of the conference. It will be very interesting to see what he has to say. I loved the one book that everybody knows is, that I love, but I think it's really a great synthesis of a whole new mind in a world is flat in an education context. Somebody tell me what the name of it is again. The global achievement gap. Sorry, I'm blanking on it. I really highly recommend that book as kind of a primer on what's going on in education. So this book that he's going to talk about in his opening address is all about innovation and is a follow-up to the global achievement gap. So we're really excited. He's going to open up the conference. All of the sessions are in Blackboard Collaborate, like what you see here, and they are all recorded. So if you miss something, you can always come back to it. We anticipate, I don't know how many people actually attend because some people go to multiple sessions, but we think about 7,000 or 8,000 people came last year. We had 13,000 individual logins over the course of the week. And people are using this in very interesting ways. A couple years ago, I have a friend who taught at an independent school in Los Angeles, and he would run different sessions in his teacher's lounge during the course of the day. So teachers who came in to work or to have lunch would be able to watch this while they were multitasking. I know a lot of higher ed people, it's very interesting to me, and I wish they would talk about what they're doing a little bit, in our community. A lot of higher ed people are having their students join and go to sessions and then blog about it or do some sort of activity with it. So I'm really interested in the creative ideas that people use to bring this content to life outside the conference, outside the actual webinar room. So if you are doing anything like that, please let us know, and we'd love to know more about your students' reactions to this if you're doing something along those lines. So this is kind of a crazy ambitious thing, and I had to have all my faith in Steve that this would work the first year. And let me tell you a little bit about the proposal process too, because I think that's really important. I'm going to click on a link right now. There's a green navigation bar at the top, and it says 2012 conference, and there's a pull-down menu. And under the pull-down menu, I'm going to actually go, if I can get there. Pull-down menus don't always work so well in here. There's one that says call for proposals. And this is how things work. We have the call for proposal open in May. And we started accepting proposals in June or July until last Monday. And the whole idea behind this is that people are empowered to take control of their professional, life, I guess. And they have to, we use a discussion forum in this thing for putting in proposals. And they have to follow directions, which are not necessarily that easy to follow. If you follow them, they work, but for new people, it may be a little intimidating. And then you follow the process, we accept you, and we're pretty accepting. We want everybody to be able to participate as long as people kind of fit our mission. And I mentioned the mission a little bit earlier. And then you have to book your presentation yourself. We don't do it for you, which is really fascinating to me. And this is all Steve's brilliant idea. He uses a tool called You Can Book Me, which lets you pick a time slot and book it into our Google Calendar. And so you're empowered to propose what you want to talk about, you're empowered to schedule yourself, and then you're empowered to publicize your particular session and get it out there. So Yes, Lucian is a presenter. Ellen is doing one too. Rhonda, are you doing one? I'm doing one this year. I usually don't, actually. So it's interesting. Yeah, so there are several presenters. And you can book me. It's fascinating because you can kind of set your, it's like a $20 tool that you buy to use with Google Calendar, and you can, you know, you can set the parameters for what people can pick for time slots and that sort of thing. So that's how people kind of do it. And I'll talk a little bit about where to find those proposals in a second. But we kind of outline the whole process here. And, you know, it's important that people kind of read the directions and, you know, and if they have a question, they can ask. We have a chat room at the very bottom, and usually there's somebody in there who can help you with it. So the call for proposals ended last Monday, and we've been madly accepting them or going back to people and saying, hey, we need you to put more global language in here because I'm really focused on our mission. I don't want general education stuff in here unless it has some sort of global context. And this is not about technology either. A lot of people are confused. They think this is a technology conference. It's not. The technology supports what we do, but it's not all about the technology. So this is about global collaboration and communication and connecting. And we've tried to make it abundantly clear, but for some time, for some people, it kind of escapes them. So that's been a little frustrating for me personally, but we're getting there. I think we're communicating it a little bit better. So that's the conference in a nutshell. Let me show you how to get around this space, and because I think that's the trickiest thing for everyone. And please let me know if you have any questions in the chat, and I'll try and address them as we go. So when you come to globaleducationconference.com, you're going to see a green navigation bar at the top. This leads you to the major channels within our website. It's dark green. It has white text. When you hover over it, it has blue text. And you will also see in the upper right-hand corner a search box that you can search for topics and people and that sort of thing. It's not the world's greatest search tool, but it will get you what you need to know usually. So realize that that's there. And then the rest of the front page is like a newspaper. They are boxes of content that will lead you to more behind the scenes. So think of this as a newspaper. This is what the Ning platform does. And we've tried to streamline it and make it as simple as possible, but there's some stuff that we can't leave off here or else people will never find it. There are multiple ways to get to certain things too, so keep that in mind. And we want you to be able to, if you need help with something, and you've dug around and looked yourself, there is a chat room at the very, very bottom that you can turn on and off, and you can ask and see if somebody's around and if they can answer a question for you. We have 22 people online right now from what I can tell in my web tour, so there's a good chance you might get a question answered if you ask it there. So moving down the page, I'm scrolling down a little bit. There's another area that's really, really important, and if you go down, if you keep scrolling down, to about the middle of the page on the left-hand side, you're going to see something that says conference links. And this is also a shortcut to some of the more important links that are associated with the conference. You will also notice that there is something that says the IRON Annual Conference and Youth Summit. This is new this year, and we're really thrilled about this. IRON stands for the International Education and Resource Network. They are probably the most established, global education group in the United States, and they have chapters around the globe. And they are, this year they normally have a face-to-face conference, and I don't think face-to-face is going away. I think face-to-face is still needed, so I don't think virtual is the be-all and end-all by any means. But IRON's face-to-face conference was going to have some logistical issues this year. And so they decided, hey, let's partner with the Global Ed Conference and see if we can do it online and see how it goes. And so they are having, next year they'll have their face-to-face one in Qatar, this in Doha. this year they're going to do it online. And so they also have been running their call for proposals and everything simultaneous to us. So when you actually go to our schedule, you'll see our regular Global Education Conference sessions scheduled, and you will also see their sessions. And you are welcome to go to their sessions as well. So, you know, we're really pleased with the guidance and support that IRON has given us throughout the inception of this conference, but we're even more pleased that they're partnered with us this year. Diane Midness is kind of their coordinator with this online. Ed Greger is their executive director emeritus, who's been phenomenal. He just brought in one of our keynotes, Randy Weingarten of AFT. And he may actually be in the chat. He was going to try and come by today. He's been phenomenal at advising us and supporting us. And then their executive director, Lisa Jobson, has also been incredibly helpful in this whole process. So we're really pleased to have this kind of simultaneous part of the conference next to us, okay? IRON, by the way, has a really excellent project book. Maybe Peggy will find the link to it, that has a lot of interesting projects listed if you're looking for inspiration for global projects. So that's the navigation piece of it. You've got the search box, you've got the green navigation at the top on every page, and then you've got those conference links on the left. Let me kind of dig down on the front page a little bit and tell you the other pieces of this. At the very top, underneath the green navigation bar, you're going to see your personal information on the left if you're logged in. You'll see mine right now, Lucy Gray. And that there's like a messaging area. People can send you messages within the Ning. And you'll also see a box called members. And the highlighted members that you see there are members of our leadership team. These are people who've been actively involved in the conference for the past couple of years and that do a lot of the heavy lifting for the conference. So for instance, you'll see Anne Merchant, who I'm sure has been in Classroom 2.0 Live, who's in Australia. And she's great because she's when Steve and I go to sleep during the conference, she's up doing, it's her daytime hours, and she can help monitor things during the day. So you'll see a lot of people there that you may know of. And these people have been instrumental in helping us run the conference. So those people on the front page right there under members are people that you can count on. If you want to actually reach out to them and ask them questions, they'd be happy to help you. But those are our featured members. If you want to see all of the members, you can go to the green navigation bar that I mentioned earlier, or there's a link on the right-hand side of this members box that says View All. And what's nice about this, I'm going to click on that right now, is you can search this member directory. So I've had friends who are working on projects on different themes, and you know, my friend Valerie Becker has done, you know, projects like whaling around the world, whaling communities around the world, because she lives in Martha's Vineyard, and that used to be a whaling community. So she'll find, you know, people in Japan or Iceland or places where whaling has occurred, and they'll do projects on that topic. So this is useful if you're looking for people from a particular area of the world or grade level or whatever. There's an advanced search box that will let you kind of sort things out here. So if you want to see all of the members, we have 13,600 right now. We're growing very rapidly. It's pretty amazing. This will show you, give you links to people's profiles, and you can see what they're up to, and you can send them a message. We do not put people's email addresses publicly on this thing. If you want to message them and get their email, then you can do it through the system, but we keep email private for, I can see it, but you guys can't. For privacy concerns. But the messaging system will send a message to their email, so be aware of that. Back on the home page, I'm moving down the page, and I'm on groups now, which is right below the members in the front page. You'll see to the left we have a translate box with Google, which works somewhat. It's not, you know, the best translator, but it's better than nothing for people who are non-English speakers. We also have groups, and the groups that you see featured on the front page are official conference groups, and there are a lot more behind the scenes. So these groups are, you know, our partner organizations, people who want to serve on our international advisory board, people who are volunteering to moderate sessions, and we would love for you guys to help out with that. It's a great way to learn Blackboard Collaborate, and we really count on our volunteers for that. And then there's also a group for presenters. these basically serve as mailing lists to these particular populations. So if we need information to get out just to our presenters and not the whole community, we'll use this space. There are other groups, by the way. If you click on the View All button at the bottom of that groups box, you are going to see a lot more groups. So one of my favorite groups is our Skype group. There is a Skype group somewhere. I'm going to sort these by most members because then you can see it. There's a Skype group for people who are interested in doing Skype Skype in between classrooms and that sort of thing. There is a group for people who are interested in global awareness curriculum. There's a group for people who want to connect over Twitter. So be aware that there's a lot more social networking going on behind the scenes in these groups. Okay? I'm going to go back to the front page again and make sure that you know where we are. So I've talked about members. I've talked about groups on the front page. The next box down, on the left-hand side, you're going to see a box that says Start Here. This is a good starting place for people who are new to the Ning. I'm trying to kind of give some basic navigation to them. What's been interesting about this is that a lot of people come in here and they go, what's the value here for me? What do I do? Where do I start? They're overwhelmed by this amount of information. So I created the Start Here box for those people. And people also come in here and go, how do I register? How do I pay? How do I get there? And I want to make it abundantly clear, this is free. This is online. You don't need to register. If you do register on our site, it's nice because you get email updates, but you absolutely don't have to. You can access all of this without having to join our community. We would like you to be part of the community, but you don't have to be. So that's what the Start Here box is for. And then to the right of that on the front page, you'll see forum. And this is our discussion forum. And the most recent discussions will pop up here that I've actually featured. So these may be some opportunities for you. For instance, Primary Source, which has been a big supporter of our conference, is offering a travel tour to Peru. And so they've posted it there. I posted something here about this Classroom 2.0 live show. Another member wants people to do a survey. So opportunities aside from the conference will be here. If people have a project they want to publicize, if they have a question, if they're wondering where to go for something, that's where they go. There's hundreds of posts in here behind the scenes. And again, in the lower right-hand corner of the forum box, you'll see View All, and you will see the entire discussion forum and the different categories. And so you'll see, if you click on that link, it's globaleducationconference.com/forum. You're going to see there's 443 posts about collaborative projects. Or you'll see that there's 93 posts about conferences and professional development resources. So there's something for everyone, including, this is where all the proposals for the conference went, into this area. You'll see the submissions that haven't been accepted yet. You'll see the ones that have been accepted. You'll see last year's stuff, too. But the discussion forum is really important part of this community. And there's more behind the scenes. So I'm going back to the front page. And on the left-hand side, and underneath forum, on the left-hand sidebar, you'll also see a video that kind of explains what I'm talking about. This video has been created for us by Christopher Tully, who's an Apple Distinguished Educator in Pennsylvania in Bucks County. His students did a series of videos for us this year, and we're so pleased and so excited that they did this and thankful to them. So there's a video for those who prefer a video format of knowing what's going on. Hopefully they're going to be doing some more videos during the conference, kind of like ISTE does at the end of the conference, or during the conference they have little videos that kind of tell you what's going on, newsy kinds of videos. We hope the kids are going to be doing that as well. The next section in the middle, down the page, is latest activity. And this is kind of where I have Twitter feeding in here. So anybody that's used our hashtag, which is GlobalEd12, the tweets will pop up here. If you've posted a recent post in our discussion forum, it will also pop up here. So just keep that in mind. And again, on the left-hand side, you're going to see the conference links at this point, too. So I'm scrolling down a little bit further. I'm almost done, and then I'll take questions in a second with giving you the top over the overview, and then we can talk a little bit about some new stuff with the conference. If I scroll down further past the latest activity, you're going to see conference badges that you can put on your website or your Twitter account, and you'll also see a feed from our DIGO bookmarking group in here on global education stuff. So this is actually a feed from another tool, and we have a group where anyone can bookmark stuff related to global collaboration, and the most recent ones will feed in here. If you click on the More button, or More link on the right-hand side of this box, you're going to be taken to the DIGO group, and you can see how we're bookmarking resources on the fly. Okay. Scrolling down further, we have events. Anyone's welcome to post their event there. And we have a very cool Prezi by Chris Smith, who's on our advisory board, that explains the conference. And I'm moving down further. We have notes of some interesting things, like we have a key of a group. And then we have conference documents, which are kind of press releases and posters and stuff that we've put together, including Spanish and French documents about the conference. You will also see blog posts from some members, which are, this is more of a reflective space. If you use the blog post tool, it's basically kind of reflections on things, and I highlight the ones that I think are the most interesting to our members, and they appear on the front page. And then I'm scrolling down, and we're almost done with the kind of the tour of this. You'll see videos on the left-hand side. And again, these are ones that I've posted and featured. There are a lot more behind the scenes. I think we have 400 videos that are posted in here. But these are the ones I think are the most important right now. And you'll see three that have been done by those Buck County, Buck Institute of Technology kids on how to submit a proposal, how to use Blackboard Collaborate, you know, that kind of stuff. They've posted some tutorials there that are really nice. And then down at the bottom, you'll see just some photos that people have put up and that sort of thing. So that's the front page of our community. It's overwhelming. There's a lot of information in there. But that kind of gives you, you know, an overview of how to get around this place, which I think is half the battle. Anybody have any questions about the front page and the stuff that you're seeing in the front so far? I see that you guys are talking about Shambles Guru, Chris Smith. Yes, he's great. He's the one who did the Prezi down there, and he's been he's a social media guru for sure. And you need to, with him, his big thing has been you have to tag everything with our tag so that he can find it. So Global Ed 12. Speaking of the tag, one of the things that we're toying with right now, we need to decide very soon if we're going to do this or not. People really want a certificate of attendance for coming to the conference. And we're thinking of doing something that will make this possible. Basically because we're limited in our resources, we haven't done this, and at this point we're not offering credit, but I'm thinking that we may offer a certificate of attendance if people will view the session live, not recorded, take a screenshot of what they're seeing, and then blog about it and submit the link to us, then we'll give a certificate of attendance. We're thinking about this, and if we do it, I just need to make sure we have the manpower to send off all these certificates by email. We'll probably announce it next week. So that's one thing that people have been asking for, and it would be really nice to be able to kind of acknowledge, you know, people's attendance in this. We're really kind of an informal grassroots kind of thing. This is not a university-driven kind of thing. We've not had a lot of sponsorship until this year. So this is something that we need to consider as an asset. There is a banner for the conference that you can add to your Twitter avatar. It's under press materials. You can go to it in the green navigation bar. You'll see press and media. It's also under conference links. And I'll click on that right now. And you're going to see at the very top a link to badges and artwork. it's not very obvious. It's at the very, very, very top. And there's tons of badges that you can use in order to publicize the conference. Thank you, Peggy, for finding that. Okay, now we have some cool new things I want to show you and talk about a little bit. One is we have
some
keynotes. And I'm going to go to the conference. Lorna, do you have a question?
No, I was just going to...
When you talk. Let me turn off my microphone.
Okay, I was just going to make a suggestion. At some point with their discussion, did you want to invite people to come to Mike with their experiences about the conference? I know we have a couple people that are working with you that are in the chat.
Sure, but I'm not done. I need to talk about a couple of these new things, and then we'll do that. Okay?
Okay, how's great.
That
sound? That's
okay,
wonderful.
So here's the next thing that you need to know is that we have some amazing keynotes coming. So if you click on the green navigation bar, this also works in the conference links, you will see something that says keynotes. And I'm going to scroll down and use the pull-down menu doesn't work well for me in Blackboard Collaborate. I'm going to use the conference links on the left-hand side. And we have 30 keynotes. I can never stop with just a few. And hopefully this is coming up. It's taking a minute here. Keynotes, come on up. And we have a slew of people that have some sort of global perspective. I think that's worth sharing with the audience. And these people are all volunteering their time. And they're very high level people that I think one of the pieces of feedback we've gotten in the past is that it's like being up close and personal with some of these people that you may have admired or heard about in the course of your work. And the most, I'm really excited, I mean, I'm excited by all of them and honored to have all of them come. But some of them that you may have heard of, Karen Cater from the U.S. Department of Education is coming. Dale Doherty, who is the founder of Make Magazine, and the whole Maker movement, which I think is fascinating, is another highlight. We have Jeremy Gilley, who is the founder of Peace One Day, which is a global ceasefire movement. It's pretty inspiring. He is an intense, passionate guy about this, and he's created all sorts of media around this project he's been doing for a number of years. So you may want to check his bio out. Beth Cantor, who's a social media guru with nonprofits, she's very highly regarded in Silicon Valley. She's coming. Who else? Oh, the big announcement has been that we're having Randy Weingarten from the AFT, the president of the AFT, the American Federation of Teachers, who's going to address us. So we're really thrilled about that. One of the other people that we're having is Seymour Simon and his wife Liz Neon. Seymour followed me on Twitter, and if you've ever taught first, second, third grade, you probably have seen Seymour's books. He's a prolific nonfiction photography book writer for kids. Amazing stories. And he started following me on Twitter, and I was like shocked that somebody famous would be following me. And so I sent him a direct message and said, hey, you want to keynote this conference? And he was like all over it. He loved it. And he's been tweeting about it and been very participatory. And I'm really thrilled to meet this man because he just seems like a Renaissance kind of guy. And we have Tony Wagner, of course. There's Randy Weingarten at the very bottom. But we have an amazing lineup of keynotes. That's one highlight of the conference. We also have two new strands of the conference, and then we can talk about this a little bit more. I'm sorry to talk so much at you guys, but this is a lot of important information. We have two new strands. In addition to teacher, student, curriculum, policy, and leadership, we have a new strand on gaming that BrainPop is sponsoring. So we will have next week all of the sessions that are tagged gaming up so that you can see them. But there is a new strand on this. On the left-hand side, under conference links, you can see information about that strand. And then we also have a new one focused on EdTech startups that have a global perspective. And this one is sponsored by Cisco's Get Ideas. I'm also doing some work on the side for Get Ideas. It's their leadership community. and I'm going to pull up that link right now. And I'm vetting right now about 40 proposals from EdTech startups who are going to, they're going to use this opportunity to engage with educators about their work and get feedback and also tell you about what they're doing in terms of providing tools that will help you connect your classroom. We have a pretty wide variety of groups that are doing this. It's pretty interesting. So that announcement is in terms of, who actually will be presenting. I'm going to let them know on Monday, I believe, is when I have to send them their acceptance letters. So this is all about technology-driven innovation with a global perspective. Bobby Kershon, who used to be head of Kriki, is going to be keynoting for this strand, and we're really thrilled about it. So those are two new things. We're also doing a film exhibition, and more details about that are coming. I have to go through about a dozen films and decide which ones are going to be featured. So that's all I have to say about the conference. Why don't we share, does anybody want to share about their experiences or ask any questions, and I'll shut up for a few minutes?
If you do want to come to the mic, and could you just raise your hand if I don't see you in the chat, or so that I know that I'll give you mic access? Marley, I'm not sure if we resolved this question about Peggy having a question about the Twitter badge and the profile image. Did you see that question a while back?
Yeah, I answered it.
Okay,
it's under,
sorry.
And she put the link in. So okay. I think we've got that there. It's under press and media.
So we have people being a little shy or just not their microphone set up this morning. Yeah, right. Alan wants to give it a try here. I'm just going to give you privileges then, Alan. You should have a mic access and just turn it up. Great. Can hear
yeah,
you. Thank you. Yes, very
yes,
well.
I was trying to write in a chat box, but I wasn't able to write. I don't know why. Anyway, I actually just want to confirm everything what Lucy said. I've been participating last year, and Lucy invited me to participate even more this year. And what's very, very good about this conference, I'm actually not an educator. I'm not teaching. I was a student assistant at my faculty. However, I now have a new job. I'm working as an information security consultant. But I've been participating in different projects going around globally. And that's what I've been presenting about last year. And that's what I'm going to present about this year. And that's what's really good about this conference. So what Lucy mentioned, this is not about technology, it's about education and global awareness, and that's what we are doing at our faculty here in Croatia. We've been collaborating with University of Central Florida, and we've been collaborating with DePaul University in Chicago. And this conference actually gave us an idea about how to make a conference for university students, undergraduate and graduate students, and that's what we are doing. We are going to have an International Student Research Symposium that's going to be a fully online conference, pretty similar to this one, although it's going to be on the university level for students. So this conference really is a great place to meet different people, share ideas. And last year, I can remember, I even participated in some sessions that I was just interested in. There were some great discussions and a great presentations, and it's really, out of so many sessions, I'm sure everyone can find something for themselves.
Testing. Can you hear me?
Go ahead.
Okay. Great. Thanks, Lorna. I really couldn't think of a question. There's so much on that website, Lucy, and And I cannot say enough thank yous to all the people who volunteered time and energy to put all of that together. It really is an amazing conference, an amazing opportunity. I think I responded to your question in the chat that said, yeah, I think once we start talking about a global education conference, it's, for me at least, and Alan, thank you for sharing your contribution to the University of Central Florida, but for me here in Florida, and I'm in the Central Florida area as well, and I'm an alumni of the University of Central Florida, it's still sometimes overwhelming for people to hear about a global education conference, taking education to a higher level. And I think there's a lot of reasons for that, and that sometimes it's not just about directing them to these opportunities, it's about helping them plan or organize or see the benefit of, you know, getting involved with one project or connecting with the people in their area or even sharing with parents, because most of the time our parents are the least involved in the process and we wind up losing a lot of the energy of what we create in the classrooms. So I'm really looking forward to, and I've said this to Peggy before, all the information that we get. It's so inspiring and exciting that I bowl people over with, you know, excitement every time I see them. And it keeps me up at night thinking about more ways and more things to do, so much so that I don't know how Lucy stays awake all day long, because I know the I guess I know the adrenaline rush, but I try to bring myself down and breathe every once in a while. And I think for me, what I've learned most since the last Global Education Conference, which was my first one, is to take it in the steps that are most appropriate for the people that are that I'm working with or working to support, or even the things that I'm trying to do as a parent for my own children, applying what there is and in ways that are meaningful and exciting to those who I'm working with, if it's my children or if it's community members or if it's educators or if it's business people, to help them work together. Because global education is so much more than just what the educators can do in the classroom, but it's about supporting it once the kids are outside of the classroom. At least that's what it is for me. So I look forward to it, and again, thank you so much for all of the efforts that have been put into this and continue to try to be associated and connected to as many things as Classroom 2.0 does and the future of education and now the Global Education Conference. So I'm looking forward to a great conference. I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
This reminds me a lot of you know, one of the candidates I most admire is Karen Cater.
Thank you very much.
A chance to hear her speak, particularly in person, you know, it's a great opportunity. And she's going to be keynoting for us, obviously. And she often talks about two things. One, the highly connected teacher, connected to data, connected to resources, connected to each other. And I think this is kind of the ultimate in helping educators to become connected. And two, she also talks about teachers needing to be inspired. And you alluded to this, Rhonda, and I think that this is really, 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 really important. You know, I'm really kind of tired of some of the negativity that's gone around the teaching profession. Even though I'm not in a school, I still associate myself very closely with the teacher mindset. And I know that if I were in schools right now, I would be feeling fairly depressed. And so this is an opportunity where I have never personally experienced anything as professionally rewarding as this event. And not because of anything I've done particularly, but because I see the conversations and I see people getting excited. I see this one woman that retired last year, I can't remember her name, in Connecticut. She spent like the entire week online. And she, I don't think, like Rhonda, I don't think she's expecting to be taken in and be so excited about this. And she couldn't sleep either. And she was just raving about it afterwards and seeing how she got inspired. If that happens with just one person, I'm happy, and I think it happened with more. And it's always really rewarding to hear these stories afterwards. And I encourage people to reflect on this somehow during the conference, either in the community, starting a blog post, or writing on your own blog and tagging it GlobalEd12. But let's share some of the stuff that's coming out of this. It might have been Carolyn Stanley, She was amazing. She was hilarious. So anyway, I'll shut up for now. But thank you everybody for coming and for supporting us and for keeping spreading the word. Let's get the word out in the next week to get people to come and participate, whether it's in the archives or the live sessions. We really would love to see more people know about this. Thank you.
Thank you, Lucy. I appreciate the overview and the insights into participating in the conference. I just want to address give you one more question before I close out the show, and I don't know if you picked it up. Nikki was asking about how many languages there are throughout the conference, and do you have any idea which ones they are?
Okay, so this is an area that we need help on somehow. We have a Spanish coordinator that you can, if you're a Spanish speaker, you can reach out to for more guidance. His name is Tomas Chascal. He is in Bogota, Colombia, I believe. He's featured on the front page. We have some Spanish language materials, but we did not get the call for proposals translated into Spanish somehow. I don't know how that escaped us. I think there are fewer Spanish proposals this year than there have been. We also have a board member, Adina Popa, who is from Romania, and she's been really great about getting Romanian participation. IERN has brought in a lot of people from the Middle East in general this year, so I think we have some positions, I don't know if it'll necessarily be in Arabic, but we should have some presentations from the Middle East. I know that we have one session in Portuguese, and it's going to be kind of hard to find these unless you search for that keyword. I'm also going to try and encourage speakers to tag their presentations with whatever language they're in so that we can easily find them. But we have not kind of gotten the language thing down yet. If you know of anybody who wants to translate, who wants to moderate a session in another language, that sort of thing, let us know. We'd love to hear from you.
Great. Thanks very much, Lucy. We are almost at the top of the hour. I need to pass on some closing information. So we'll just check back with you in just a few minutes. Just for everyone's information, Future of Education interviews this week are on Wednesday, November 7th, Flipping the Classroom, and on Thursday, November 8th. Wednesday's the 7th, Thursday's the 8th. With Tony Jackson and Veronica Boyd-Mansilla on Educating for Global Competence, Preparing Our Youth to Engage the World. And, of course, we know that the conference is coming up November 12th to the 17th. On our upcoming shows, we have some great things to offer for you. Kate Flippin, an online assessments and data collection. Featured teacher Stephen Davis on November the 17th. Again, the conference will be going on in that week as well. Some people will not be... will not be having a show on the 24th of November for the USA Thanksgiving. And we just about got our December lineup as well, but we'll be letting you know that next week. I want to remind you, those people in the room have a featured teacher you'd like to nominate. We're always looking for teachers who are in the classroom or in the middle of a project and want to share their experiences with them. There is a form in the a link to the form in the survey, as well as in the live binder, to the nomination form that you can fill out for us. So please go ahead, and if you want to nominate yourself, that's great as well. The survey link will pop up for most of you when the window shuts, you've logged out of Blackboard Collaborate, you're going to get the survey popping up. If not, look for it in the live binder, and there's a link in the resources for Classroom 2.0 Live, and you can find the survey there. For those of you who are looking for a professional development certificate, you want to find the link into it in the survey, requesting your name and email access so we can send the certificate to you. We thank Peggy very much for faithfully doing that after every session. She's a pro at organizing that content. Thank you. We have a iTunes U channel, a little bit of a tongue twister here. We have a video collection and audio collection, and that's the URL for it, and you'll also find a link to that in the live binder. We want to point out, too, that our website, as a member says, Archives and Resources page, has a blog post for every show, and there is an RSS feed, so you can subscribe to the blog and our contact through the RSS feed, or you can subscribe using iTunes to the actual video audio files. Our special thanks, Lucy, very much for taking the opportunity to walk us through the Global Education Conference and how to participate. That was great directions, and I'm sure I'm not the only one that wouldn't have found a great deal of the information that you've pointed us today. We want to thank Steve Hargadon today, the founder of Classroom 2.0, Teacher 2.0, Future of Education, and Web 2.0 Labs Project. Weebly.com for providing our support for our website. For everyone here for being with us, sharing your content, comments and ideas in the chat and coming to the microphone, thank you very much. Blackboard Collaborate sent a special thank you to them for providing the platform on which we run our sessions. So thank you everyone again for being with us today. Lucy, if you want to have a couple of last words for the day, the microphone is yours.
The thing that drives me is professional generosity and the idea that together we can do more. And Classroom 2.0 Live is a great example of that. Peggy and Lorna have modeled this for years, and I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. And I hope you guys will join us in about a week to jump into it, into the pool of professional generosity that's going to go on globally in a week. So thanks again, everybody.
And thank you very much, Lucy. Thank you, everyone, and have a good weekend. It's still kind of sunny here in St. Catharines. I hope everyone has good weather today. See you next week.